Let's give a hand as while you stand up to Marilyn Neubau, evangelist there in the door. Come on.
Well, that was awesome. What a beautiful proposal. It makes you, everybody's makeup's all messed up now. You may be seated. Thank you, awesome worship team. You know, I love this church because you're so happy, you're worshipers, and a spirit of excellence, and it's great. And I want to thank Pastor Tommy and Sarah for having me come back here again to be with you all. I think the last time I was here, I was sharing with you about a new area of my ministry, Dan and Tony's Life Center, a center that we're building in Oceanside in honor of our two police officers that had lost their lives, and it's to reach out to at-risk kids. So that's moving right along. We finally got all the legal work done. It takes longer than you think, but we got all that done, and now we're just praying in some teachers to work with these kids and teach them. And like Pastor Tommy said, I travel all around the world, and this is January, and I've already got 9 countries scheduled for this year, so, but God is good, amen? Amen? Amen. So, you know, when a carpenter builds a house, he uses tools, and for you and I to build our faith, we have to use tools, amen? Amen. And so out in the foyer, I did bring a tool table with me, and it's filled with lots of awesome, awesome products. And it's for you to take so that you can grow and build your faith. Because, you know, we have to walk by faith and live by faith. You've got to think, speak, breathe faith. Amen? Yeah. So one of the things we have back there is a laminated card designed to go in the bathroom. And there's scriptures on both sides. One's for health and one's for wealth. And the purpose of those two topics is because that's the area where the devil will attack you the most to keep you from doing kingdom business. You know, God's word is a lamp unto our feet and a light unto our path. So you want to light your path first thing in the morning. As soon as you're shampooing your hair, you can be lighting your spirit with the word. Amen? So you can go back to that table. Then we have a packet of healing scripture cards, and there's a prayer in the back, very powerful prayer that I will be actually using that in my message today. Lots of things I'm going to be teaching on healing today, and I would encourage you, if you don't have this little book on instructions from the great physician, you need to have this book, because we have so many testimonies. We've had that's the second book I've written, and we've had thousands of those books already been sold. So I would encourage you to get into those materials and build your faith. Amen. Amen. How many are ready for the word?
Amen.
Amen. Well, I titled my message today, How Can I Say I'm Healed When My Body Says I'm Sick? It's a good question, isn't it? Well, the answer is very simple, because it is written. In Isaiah 53:5, it says, by his stripes you are healed. 1 Peter 2:24 says, by his stripes you were healed. So if the Bible says you are and you were, then honey, you is. Amen? So I want you to say this with me. I is healed.
I is healed now.
Because it is written. Amen? So see, we need to see ourselves as the Word of God says we are. In 2 Corinthians 5:7, it says that we walk by faith, not by sight. What that means is that we walk by truth, not by the facts. We have to govern our heart by the truth of God's word. So we walk by truth, not by facts. And see, faith is of the heart. So we have to live from the inside out. Faith is the eye that sees the invisible. The eye of faith sees first what the natural eye does not yet see. Amen. Turn, if you will, to the Gospel of Luke. Luke 18:27. This is Jesus speaking. By the way, Pastor Sarah, that was an excellent teaching you did this morning. Just excellent. In Luke 18:27, this is Jesus speaking. He says, the things that are impossible with man are possible with who? With God. I like to say it like this. The things that are impossible with the doctor is still possible with God. So remember, the eye of faith sees first what the natural eye does not yet see. You know, I grew up going to church. I've been in church since I was 23 days old, so I've been there a long time. And in those early years, there were two things I learned about God, that God is good and that God is love. And somehow I just grabbed hold of that for me personally. And in all those early years, actually out of 28 years of being in church and Sunday school, I almost had a perfect attendance. But in those 28 years, I never heard one message on healing. And at the age of 28, I became very sick with cancer. I had cancer of the appendix. It's a very rare kind of cancer. I was told that I was approximately the eighth person in the United States to be recorded of that kind of cancer. And not only is it rare, but it's also very difficult for the doctors to recognize it. So I'd been sick about 4 or 5 months and just getting worse and worse. And finally the doctor said, Marilyn, we do not know what's wrong with you. So we're going to put you back in the hospital. And this time we're going to do exploratory surgery. And maybe we'll find the problem. As soon as I was admitted into the hospital, the nurse came in to prep me for surgery. But because they didn't know what was wrong with me, they gave me a wrong procedure. And that procedure put pressure on my appendix and caused them to begin to rupture. It actually felt like there was a volcano on the inside about to erupt. And I knew something was seriously wrong. The nurses came in, gave me the procedure, and left the room. I'm there all alone. And I felt very sick, very nauseated. The pain had seriously increased, and I knew I needed to get into the restroom. It was a struggle to get out of bed. I'm holding onto the bed, holding onto the wall, but I made it into the restroom. And I saw something that grabbed my attention, a little red button on the side of the wall that said, emergency button. And I knew I needed to hit that button. And when I reached out to touch that button, God, in all of his love, all of his goodness, all of his faithfulness, he intervened in my life. My finger actually bounced away from the button. I made a second attempt to hit the button, and again, my finger literally bounced away. It was like, boing, boing. And I thought, what is that? I have to hit the button. So I reached out a third time, but this with my whole hand. And I reached out, and suddenly I could feel that there was a wall between my hand and that button. I couldn't see it, but I could feel. I thought, well, there's a wall here. And I couldn't get beyond the wall. And I thought to myself, invisible wall, that does not compute to us. And I no more had that thought when I heard the voice of the Lord speak to me. And it was as clear as though it were audible. He spoke three times. And the first thing he said was, your time is up. Under your present condition, you are destined to die. That's a strong report when it's coming from the throne of God. I'm only 28 years old with two little children at home. And then the Lord spoke the second time. He said, your life has been removed from the hands of mankind. Your condition is now beyond the help of the medical profession. And I knew he was talking about something about that procedure. It's too late to get into the operating room. And then he spoke the third time, and it was the most beautiful of all because he began to quote from the Gospel of John. He said, I am the way, the truth, and the life. And then he said, through me, you can change your destiny. You don't have to die. And I immediately responded back to the Lord, and I said, Lord, I've read that scripture so many times. And I always thought you were talking about spiritual salvation only. And I know the day I got born again. So you must be talking about a physical salvation, not just a spiritual salvation. And I said, Lord, I don't know anything about healing. But I do know that you love me. And I do know that you're good to me. And if you are telling me that you have a healing for me, I take it. Now, I want to interrupt my testimony to say something very important. It was very easy for me to respond to the Lord the way I did, just because for all those 28 years, when I was very young, my mother gave me a little tiny white Bible. And I read that Bible every night, but when I went to bed, didn't understand all of it, but I just checked off this chapter, that chapter, just checking it off. But what was I doing? I was attuning my ear to the voice of the Lord. And so when he spoke to me that day, I immediately recognized, that's God. But see, if we don't take time to spend time with him every day, he will always speak to you because he loves you that much. But if you don't know how to recognize his voice, you could miss a miracle. You could miss the leading of the Holy Ghost. So it's so critical that you take time to spend time with him every day. And I said, Lord, I don't know anything about healing, but I know you love me. And if you have a healing for me, I take it. Now, having no knowledge, I wasn't sure what to expect to happen, but it just seemed at that moment my pain just magnified. And fear wanted to grip me. You know, I had no knowledge. It's easy to get into fear. But I don't know how I knew it, but somehow I just knew, don't give place to fear. And I took my left hand and I grabbed my stomach. It was so intense pain. I thought I was actually going to collapse to the floor. And I took my right hand and I reached out to hold on to the railing that's on the side of the hospital bathroom wall. And then everything within me, I cried out to God. I said, God, help me. Help me. Help me. And at that moment, the scripture in Isaiah 41:13 came alive. It says, for I, the Lord your God, will take hold of your right hand. Fear not, I will help you. Is that not just the most awesome scripture when you're crying out to help me, help me? He says, I will help you. And at that moment, I literally felt Jesus take hold of my right hand. I looked over at my hand. I could not see Jesus, but I could feel his fingers and his thumb, and he squeezed my hand. And it was a gentle squeeze, but at the same time, there was so much authority in that touch. And I began to sense agape love like I've never experienced in all my life. And then all of a sudden, heat started coming out of his hand into my hand, and that he started to move up my arm. By the time it reached my shoulder, the best way for me to describe it is the motion of lift continued, and the Lord lifted my spirit out of my body. How many of you know you are a spirit, you have a soul, and you live in a body? I did not know that. And the Lord lifted my spirit out of my body, and he opened my eyes to look into the spirit realm, and I actually saw my spirit. He began to teach me many things, and in a few moments, I'm going to give you some illustrations to share with you and to show with you what the Lord taught me. But when he finished teaching me, Jesus let go of my hand, and I was instantly, I was back in my body, and I touched all around my stomach, and I took a deep breath, and I thought, well, there's no pain. There's no pain. I'm healed. Praise God. But I didn't know yet what I was healed of. All I knew, I'd just been touched by God, and all I wanted to do was go back to my bed and worship. I didn't want to talk to anybody. I'm just going to embrace what had just happened to me. About an hour later, an orderly came to take me down to the operating room. Next thing I knew, I'm back in recovery. The doctor came in to talk to me, and he says, Marilyn, something must have happened to you before the operation. He said, because during surgery, I found cancer. But the cancer, it was like it was just in a little bubble all by itself. He said, it wasn't attached to anything. It was all by itself. I just reached down and I picked it up and I took it out. I didn't have to cut anything because it wasn't attached. Therefore, you don't need chemotherapy. You don't need any radiation because it wasn't attached to anything. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. And back then, they would admit if they made a mistake. And he said, you know, we gave you a wrong procedure, and that procedure should have killed you. If that cancer would have, if your stomach would have erupted or your appendix would have exploded, that cancer would have spread throughout your entire system, and it would have killed you. He said, but I know something happened. And later, when I was all alone in my room, I heard the Lord speak to me one more time. You know, he knows us by our name. And I heard the Lord whisper, Marilyn, when I was holding your hand, I was also holding back your appendix from rupturing. So the doctor could go in and remove the cancer in its entirety because I wanted you to know exactly what I did for you. God is good. He is faithful. And he is not a respecter of persons. Now, how many like to have fun in church? Amen. I knew you would. I'm going to ask three guys, maybe three of the guys from the worship team. I just need three gentlemen to come up here really quick. Just to hold some pictures. I'm not going to make you preach or anything. Just hold some pictures. Hallelujah. Just three of you to stand right over here. I'll let you hold that, and you hold the other side. Don't the guys look nice? I have you move down just a little bit, and so they can see you. You hold this. Thank you, guys. And because you're holding these dolls, I am going to promote you in a little bit. Good sportsmanship. Now, I didn't know this until the Lord. I had this experience with the Lord. But you are a spirit being. Now, I know you know this, but I want you to really get a revelation, because sometimes when you see things, it makes a larger impact. You are a spirit being. This is the part of you that is born again. This is the part of you that worships the Lord in spirit and in truth. This is the part of you. This is your soul. This is your mind, your emotions, your freedom of choice. This is the part of you that needs to be renewed to the Word of God every single day. Now, I have these two attached because whether you make your bed in heaven or in hell, your spirit and soul are always going to be together. Amen. And now, this is a house. Do y'all see this? This is what your spirit and your soul live in. That's not you. That is just a house that you live in, that your spirit and soul live in there. Just like you all live in a house somewhere. It could be single story, two-story house. But you're not in that house right now. And not everybody will have an out-of-the-body experience. But right now, you are having an out-of-the-house experience because you're not in your house. You are here in the church. But if you were to go home tonight or this afternoon and you stand outside in your driveway, and God forbid, but if your house was on fire, you would witness the destruction of your house. Amen. But you wouldn't be burned because you're not in the house. But if it's 2:00 in the morning and you were asleep and all of a sudden, whoa, it is hot in the house, and you start smelling smoke and you open that bedroom door and you step out in the hall and you find your house is a blaze of fire, you will feel the effects of that fire because you're in the house. You, spirit man, you live in this house 24/7. So every time something happens to this house, you are aware of it. Amen? Whether if this house is burning up with a fever, whether it's an excruciating pain because maybe there's cancer or destructive disease going on the inside, you will feel it. Amen? Now, just like this house has an exterior, it has a roof, it has a door, windows, that's the exterior of this house. But it also has an interior. It has electrical wiring, furniture, plumbing, all kinds of things make the inside of the house. Well, this house also has an exterior. It has hair, skin, eyes, nose, mouth. That's just the outside of this house. But this house also has an inside. It has all kinds of organs that make up the inside of this house. But this is you. And you live in this house 24/7. So once again, every time something happens to this house, you will be aware of it. And because you are a spirit being, you must be spirit-minded. Because once again, we walk by faith, not by sight. We live by faith. Because you're a spirit being, so you've got to be spiritually minded. Amen. Now, I'm going to promote you in a little bit. I'll call you back. Thank you, gentlemen. Okay. Now, I want you to turn to Romans chapter 8. Don't you just love the Word of God? I mean, it's just line upon line, precept upon precept. In Romans 8, 1, it says, "There is therefore now no condemnation to those who are in Christ Jesus, who do not walk according to the flesh." Or we could say they don't walk according to the facts, but according to the Spirit. Drop down to verse 5 of Romans 8. "Those who live according to the flesh have their mind set on what the flesh desires. But those who live in accordance with the Spirit, they have their mind set on what the Spirit desires." Now listen, the mind governed, or we could say ruled by the flesh, is death. Now that word death means defeat. There's too many Christians today saved, filled, and defeated. We're supposed to be saved, filled, and triumphant. Amen. I don't care how long you've been saved, and you can be praying in the Holy Ghost, but if you are governed by the facts, by the flesh, you will live a defeated life day after day after day. Amen. But then it goes on to say, but the mind governed by the Spirit is life, peace, healing, wholeness, victory. It's all that Calvary encompassed, amen? But we've got to be spiritually minded. Now turn to Proverbs chapter 4. Proverbs chapter 4 in verse 13. Proverbs 4:13. I was talking to you about my little book, Instructions from the Great Physician. In verse 13 it says, "Take firm hold of instructions. Do not let go. Keep her, for she is your life." It's really critical that you understand God's instructions and that you follow instructions. Just like you follow instructions when you're putting on maybe some new software on a computer or something. Amen. And now look down at verse 20. He gives us his instructions. "My son, give attention to my words. Incline your ear to my sayings. Do not let them depart from your eyes. Keep them in the middle of your heart, for they are life to those that find them and health to all their flesh." And verse 23, "Keep your heart with all diligence, for out of it are the issues of life." Those are God's instructions. And when he says in verse 23 to guard your heart, what are you supposed to guard your heart against? The facts. Guard your heart against the facts. Because if you focus on the facts, facts will breed fear. And fear is the enemy of your faith. Amen. Fear is the enemy of your faith. So guard your heart at all times. Now, when you come into agreement with God's word, you have come into agreement with the Holy Spirit, because the word of God has been inspired by the Holy Spirit. And we know that the Holy Spirit lives on the inside of us. Amen. And the Holy Spirit represents the anointing of God. So we could say the anointing of God lives on the inside of us. Or even in a more simple term, the anointing of God represents the power of God. So we could say that the power of the Almighty God lives on the inside of you and me. It's the power to remove the burden of sickness and destroy the bondage of disease. But that power does not automatically activate itself. It needs an activator. And the words that we speak is the activator. You know, so often people think that death, let me say it this way, death is not in the power of cancer. Death is in the power of the tongue. Death and life, blessings and cursings, sickness, healing, poverty, lack, prosperity, all in the power of the tongue. Amen. So we need to guard our mouth. We need to put the level of our confession needs to be on the same level as God's word. His word is truth, and we have to walk by truth and not by the facts. Now, go to Romans 8:11. Back to Romans. But if the spirit of him that raised up Jesus from the dead dwells in you, he that raised up Christ from the dead shall also quicken your mortal bodies by his spirit that dwells inside of you. Now we have the Holy Trinity, God the Father, God the Son, and God the Holy Spirit. God the Father and God the Son live in heaven. Amen? Amen. Two-thirds of the Holy Trinity lives in heaven, a beautiful place. We can't even begin to fathom the beauty of heaven. I'm sure there's colors up there we've never seen before. There's probably aromas up there we've never smelled before. I mean, it's far beyond what we could even begin to imagine how beautiful heaven is. But the other third of the Holy Trinity is not in heaven. And he's not floating around out here anywhere. He is living on the inside of you and me. That means God has imparted one-third of himself to live inside of you and me. To me, that is beyond awesome, that one-third of God, the King of the universe, the one that paints the sunset and puts the stars in place, the one that puts the aroma in the rose and the beauty of the wing of a butterfly, that power God put inside of us, one-third of the Holy Trinity. You know, we hear so much about the war and bombs and how destructive bombs are, and we know they are destructive. And they not only, I mean, if someone were to throw a bomb over here at the set of drums, it's not just going to destroy the drums. It's going to destroy everything else around it. Amen? But a bomb, as powerful as it may be, never has and never will be powerful enough to reach the pit of hell. It is never going to happen. But the same spirit that did already reach the pit of hell and raised Christ from the dead lives inside of you and me. Awesome, awesome. There's more power inside of you and me than an atomic bomb. Is a bomb isn't powerful enough to reach hell, but the Spirit of God did and raised Christ from the dead, the greatest example of his power, and it's on the inside of you and me. And that power on the inside of you and me, it has the ability to zero in on a malignant tumor and destroy all those cancer cells and never harm any healthy tissue around it. Glory, glory, glory. You've got that kind of power to lay hands on yourself or to lay hands on somebody else and expect creative miracles. Because that's the power that is on the inside of you and me. So once again, the level of our words, it must rise up to the level of truth. Amen. You see how important truth is and that we live and walk by truth? Turn, if you will, to John chapter 8. John chapter 8, verse 32. You shall know the facts, and the facts will set you free. Whoops. See, there's more people that know more about the facts than they do about the truth, but he says, you have to know the truth because it's the truth that will set you free. The facts will never set you free. You know, Christians too often judge God's will by results instead of by truth. If you get a negative report from the doctor, let me encourage you on this. Say, do not. Do not. Do not go to Mr. Google and expect to find help. He doesn't know the truth. Who put that information on Google anyway? Don't go to the library. Don't go to the internet to find help. This is where your help is, and it's on the inside of you. You must know the truth because it's the truth that's going to set you free, not the facts. Amen. Amen. Now, turn, if you would, to Colossians chapter 3. Colossians chapter 3. This is such a powerful scripture. Let the word of Christ dwell in you. And what's that very next word? Richly. The word richly is so critical because it is telling us what level to have the word dwelling on the inside of us. If you have the word in you on a rich level, you will get rich level results. But if the word is in you on a low level, you're going to get low level results. The word of God is rich. The word of God is medicine. It is full of power. The word of God is filled with God himself. Yes. And so when he tells you to put it in there on a rich level, that is a very critical statement. He's telling, this is a level, you better get that word in you. It needs to be in you on a rich level. And you know, sometimes people, if they're not sick, they think, well, I'll read healing scriptures later. You know, living in California, be it San Diego, Los Angeles, San Francisco, when they build tall buildings, they make them as earthquake-proof as they can. Amen? You know when they do it? Before the earthquake. Not in the middle of the earthquake. The wise man built his house upon the rock before the storm. If you're wise, you're going to build yourself up on faith, on healing, how to be listening to the Holy Ghost while you're healthy. Amen? Amen. Now, I've been to Africa on a number of occasions. I even actually had to sleep in a tent in lion territory. It was not my favorite hotel. But I've seen those lions when they attack a prey. Do you know what kind of prey a lion attacks? A weak one. Why? Because he knows it's very easy to devour a weak prey. Well, the Bible says that the devil goes around as a roaring lion. And the devil is looking for Christians who have the word in them on a low, weak level. Because he knows, oh, I can devour that Christian really easy. That's why God says you get that word in you on a rich level. Because the devil is going to come, amen? He's going to come and attack you, so you need to have that word in you on a rich, rich level. Now, go back to the Gospel of John. In John chapter 6, John 6:63, it says, it is the Spirit that quickens. The flesh profits nothing. Listen to this statement. The words that I speak to you, they are spirit and they are life. I think too often, we don't mean to do it, but I think sometimes we accidentally do it, if I can use that word accidentally. It's almost like we treat the word of God as though it were a magic potion. Oh, I'm healed, I'm healed, I'm healed. Praise the Lord, I'm healed. And it's just coming out of this part of you, your head and your mouth. But Jesus says, my words are spirit. So just as we have to worship in spirit and in truth, when you speak God's word, it's going to have to come from your spirit. And the only way it's going to come from your spirit is when you put it in there on a rich level. And then when you begin to speak it from your spirit, God puts life on it. And all things become possible. All things are subject to change. But you just can't go around speaking healing scriptures and never being in the word, never getting that word in you on a rich level. You've got to have it in there richly. He said so. Amen. Those are all a part of God's instructions. So we need to take God's word very seriously. You know, if you were to accumulate all the books of the Bible, or I mean all the books in the world, not just the Bible, but all the books in the entire world, do you know that you would only find one that has been breathed with the breath of God? This is the only one that has been breathed with the breath of God. And we can put that in us on a rich level and expect dynamic results. Amen. So don't treat it flippantly, because it has to be a lifestyle. It's not just what you confess on Sunday mornings or at home groups, but it's what you say at midnight when you are all alone. It's dark in the room and your body begins to scream out in pain and fear wants to grip you, and maybe pastor's on vacation. That's where you're going to win or lose the battle. When you're all alone, that's what he's going to attack. But that's where you will win or lose the battle. It's got to be in you as a lifestyle. As a lifestyle. I'm going to have my three helpers come back up here quickly. Hallelujah. You know, when you go to a doctor, you're going to get a doctor's report. And when you come to the Word of God, you're going to get the Lord's report. The report from the great physician. Where's my other? Oh, glory be. Snuck up on me. I like your sweater, by the way. I thought that was quite nice. Hallelujah. When you go to a doctor to get a doctor's report, and let's just say he's going to give you a bad report, and the first thing he says to you is, well, I'm sorry to tell you, but you have, we'll say, you have cancer. He uses that word, you. Well, which one's you? This is you. Do you have cancer? You have diabetes? Blood pressure? High blood pressure? No, no. But he said you. But if you are not spiritually minded, you will grab hold of that fearful, evil report, and you are going to start confessing that. You're going to start asking everybody to pray for you. You're going to say, please pray for me. I have. And you've taken ownership. And Mark 11:23 says, you will have whatever you say. So you must be spiritually minded. Now, you know, when we pray, our prayers will go in two different directions. Let me say something else, too, about when he says you. Living in California, my house, I have this house tested every 2 years for termites. Now, after the termite inspector checks my house and he comes knocking on the door and he says, Marilyn, I'm sorry to tell you, but you've got termites. Do you think I'm going to take that personally? No, I'm not going to take any offense to that, because I know he's just talking about wooden stubble. It's not me, but he said you have termites. Don't take it personally if the doctor says you have diabetes, you have allergies, you have cancer. Don't take it personally. You do not. Only your house. And you have authority over that house. Amen. Now, when you pray, like I said, our prayers, stay right here, I'm going to promote you. They're good sports. When we pray, our prayers often go in one of two directions. We're either asking Jesus to do something he's told us to do, or we're asking him to do something he's already done. You know, sometimes we get to the place where we just beg and plead, God, oh, Jesus, heal me, heal me. Calvary was so well done in one act, it need never to be repeated. And it's not going to be repeated. Jesus accomplished everything he will ever need to do. Amen. So we need to know, how am I supposed to be praying? You know, in Romans 8:26, it says, likewise, the Spirit helps us in our weaknesses. He helps us in our infirmities. Amen. So we're going to role play right now. Actually, I need one more brother. You want to come up here? Holly, I knew you'd want to. I just knew you were jumping at the bit to come up here and help us. I'll have you stand right here in front. How many like to role play? I'm sure you have dramas here at the church, maybe at Easter or Christmas, amen? Well, I'm going to let you be a pillar of the church. Okay. Glory to God. Glory. Probably be yourself. I'm going to let you be Jesus after the cross. You get to be the Holy Ghost. Glory. Hallelujah. You're going to be God. Just for the day. I will be the devil. I never like to ask volunteers to be the devil. So one day, what is your name?
Miguel.
One day, the devil attacks Miguel with sickness and disease. I mean, the devil comes at him really, really hard. And he turns to Jesus. And he begins to plead and beg, Jesus, heal me, heal me. And nothing happens, except he just keeps getting worse. Pretty soon, the whole church is praying for Miguel. He just gets worse and worse. And he's begging, Jesus, heal me, heal me. Nothing's happening. He's asking Jesus to do something he's already done. So he's not getting any results. That's already been checked off the list. So turn around. One day, the eyes of his understanding are enlightened. And that's why it's so critical that you always pray the prayers of the Apostle Paul, that you would receive the spirit of wisdom and revelation of the knowledge of God, that the eyes of your understanding be enlightened to the hope of his calling. Amen. You need to have spiritual enlightenment. Amen. And so one day he's just praying and speaking the word of God, and he's in the word of God, and all of a sudden the eyes of his understanding are enlightened, where Jesus says, I have given you authority to trample on serpents, on scorpions, over all the power of the enemy, and nothing by any means shall harm you. No cancer, no diabetes, no allergies, nothing should harm you. Now that he's got that revelation, he begins to take authority. And this, like I said, there's a little prayer in the back here. It says, Spirit of, we'll just say cancer, Spirit of cancer, in the name of Jesus Christ of Nazareth, I pull you down from your position of authority. And I break the power of assignment you have against me, for it is written. And now, look what happens. The whole time he was begging Jesus to help him, to heal him, was he still saved? Yeah. Still filled with the Holy Ghost? Yeah. But defeated. He was saved, filled, and defeated. And he still had that power inside, but it wasn't activated. But now that he takes that authority over the enemy, and he begins to speak, for it is written, look what happens to him now. Holy Ghost, put both your hands on his shoulders. The Holy Ghost was sent to you and me as our helper. He's going to help Miguel to not get weary in well-doing. When he prays in the Holy Ghost is going to build him up. Build him up. He's going to guide him, direct him in the way that he needs to go. The Spirit of Truth is going to guide him into all the truth about what he needs to do. Maybe something in the natural he needs to do to receive healing. But he is his helper, and now he just tapped into it. He just released that power that was there the whole time. And now look what else happened. Jesus put both your hands on his shoulders. Jesus, I think sometimes we forget this, but the Bible says that Jesus is seated at the right hand of the Father, always interceding for you and for me. Glory. You know, sometimes, oh, I got to call so-and-so to have them pray for me. Hey, you got Jesus praying for you. I don't know what Jesus is praying, but you can be sure he's got all the bases covered. Amen. Now look what else happens. God, you also put both your hands. Ooh, you feel all that power. Glory, glory. The Bible says that when he begins to speak the word from his spirit, God hears that. And God puts life on those words. And when the devil looks at Miguel, he doesn't see flesh and blood. He sees a spirit of life, a force, of authority. The devil sees the whole armor of God, the shield of faith. He sees, when you take your authority and you speak from your spirit, all of heaven backs you up. Hallelujah. Glory, glory, glory. Saved, filled, and triumphant. Hallelujah. And when he takes authority over the devil, you guys can sit down. when he takes authority over the devil, it is written he has to flee. But let me just say something about the devil. When you take your authority over the devil, he's not going to say, oh, I am so sorry, I didn't mean to bother you. Didn't know it was a bother. No. He's going to keep coming and coming and coming. You know why? Because he's checking to see what level. What level is that word in them? Is it low enough? If I keep coming, the devil's thinking, if I just keep coming, I'll be able to devour him. When the devil finds out that you're at a rich level, he has to flee. He does not have an option. A number of years ago, on one of my trips to Africa, I was taking the preventative for malaria, doing everything I'm supposed to do, and I was there for a month being bitten by mosquitoes, but I was not concerned because I was on the preventative. But it was about just a matter of 5 or 6 hours after I arrived back home in the States that suddenly I was just bombarded with symptoms of malaria. I immediately took authority over it. You think the devil was just going to, oh, well, sorry, Marilyn. No. He came back the next day, and the next day I was getting worse and worse. Now, it's never a lack of faith to go to the doctor. You're mixing wisdom with your faith. If you need a miracle and you don't get one in a reasonable period of time, I'm telling you, it's not a lack of faith. You're just mixing wisdom with your faith. So I went to the doctor, and I said, I have some symptoms, and if I can just, I have some more chloroquine, I can double up on it and just nip it in the bud. He said, oh, no, you don't have malaria because you were on the preventative. I said, well, I just know the symptoms. I've seen a lot of people with malaria. If you'll just give it, no, I won't give it to you. He said, but I will run a blood test because maybe it's just fatigue or something. Now, at that point, I did not know that he didn't know anything about malaria because malaria affects your liver, kidneys, spleen. It also destroys your blood. You're very nauseated, and you will have a very high fever and an excruciating headache. You can be very, very sick with malaria. He did the blood test, so the next day, thinking that he ran the test stat, you know, get the results right away, I called him, and I said, do you have the results? And he said, no, but don't you worry about it. It'll come in time. But he said, now, don't be calling me, though, he said. I'll call you when we get it. I said, hey, this is my dollar. It's my party. I'll cry if I want to. It's my dollar. I'll call if I want to. So I called him the next day, but he said, no, we don't have the results. Another day went by, and my fever had escalated to a little over 104. I called him up. I said, I'm very nauseated, and I'm burning up with fever. Oh, not to worry about it. Not to worry about it. You can take a cold shower. So then I realized he didn't know anything, and I was too sick to do anything. The next morning, I woke up, and my whole body was completely swollen. I had turned yellow outside, inside. My eyes were yellow. My throat was yellow. My skin was yellow. Yellow, swollen, and my fever was still escalating. I called a friend. I said, come get me to the doctor immediately. I got there. They rushed me into one of the waiting rooms because they said I looked so bad, they didn't want me to scare people. I thought, well, thanks a lot. So they rushed me into the room, and the doctor came in, and he said, wow, you are really yellow. Maybe you got hepatitis. We didn't check for hepatitis. He said, but don't worry about it. You go back home. I'll call you when I get the results. Didn't even give me an aspirin. I was just too sick to even think straight. I went home. The next morning, very early in the morning, my phone rang. It was the doctor. He said, Marilyn, we are sending an ambulance to your house because you have 2 different forms of malaria at the same time. And I've already contacted a disease specialist. He's waiting for you at the hospital. When I got there, the disease specialist says, this is the worst case I've ever seen. He says, I'm surprised you're actually able to stand. He said, however, you are also the first patient we've ever had with malaria. And now you need to be treated with quinine, and we don't have any. And this was before the computer, so now they have to call all these different hospitals to locate quinine. I was on it for 3 days, but I myself could tell it wasn't working. The specialist came in to see me, and he says, Marilyn, I'm very sorry to tell you that you are dying. And if you want to say goodbye to your family, you need to call them now, not this afternoon. Do you understand what I'm saying? Not this afternoon. And I thought to myself, God didn't heal me of cancer so I could die of malaria. That did not compute. And I want, and he said, I know you're a Christian, and if you know anybody that prays, prayer is your only hope. Well, at this point now, I do not have the ability to speak. I'm just that far gone. And I wanted to tell them I do, and they are, but I couldn't get it out. And but when I went to the hospital, I didn't call a million people to pray for me. But the couple that I did call, I said, there's two prayers. One, I do not want you to pray. Do not pray and ask Jesus to heal me when it's already been checked off the list. The only prayer I want you to pray is the prayer of the Apostle Paul in Ephesians 3:16, that I would be strengthened in might by God's Spirit in my inner man. Because I knew if I was strong on the inside, I'll get the right results on the outside. Always remember, you pray for people for inner strength, so that they do not get weary in well-doing. I fell asleep. I must have woke up at maybe, I don't know for sure, it was about maybe 3 or 4 o'clock in the morning. When I woke up, I said, oh, I'm still alive. I was really quite surprised. I was alive. I am here, you know. And I thought, you know, devil, because all week long I'd been taking my authority numerous times. And I thought, today, you are going to see me sitting up in bed. And I took a hold of the support bars on the side of my bed, and I began to pull. And it took all the energy I could muster up. And let me say this, wimpy people don't win. If you're a wimp, just forget it. Because you don't win if you're a wimp. And I took a hold of those bars, and I thought, with bulldog tenacity, I'm going to sit up in this bed. And I pulled and I pulled and I was sitting up. And then, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, spirit of malaria, I break your hold. I didn't pray anything different than I had all those other days. But it was at that point the devil saw, oh, she's at a rich level. I guess I'm going to have to flee. And immediately I knew, oh, I just got the victory. I collapsed back in bed from sheer exhaustion and walked out of the hospital 3 days later. The fever broke immediately, but the doctors, I gotta watch this. But let me just, one last thing in closing. This is a copy of one of my medical reports. It's not June 1986, Tulsa, Oklahoma, Marilyn Neubauer. These are the facts. These facts say this patient is going to die. But truth in Psalms 118 verse 17 says, this patient will not die but live and declare the works of the Lord. I went with truth, not the facts. And truth will always reverse the facts. We walk by truth, not by facts. Father, we thank you so much for your word today. We thank you, Lord, that your word never returns void. If there's anybody here today, maybe you're visiting for the first time, if you've never asked Jesus to come into your life, you don't have to hope that you'll go to heaven. You can know today that you will go to heaven and that the Holy Spirit will come and live on the inside of you. If you've never prayed that prayer, it's the most simple prayer you'll ever have to pray. And it's the biggest miracle you'd ever receive. If you've never prayed and asked Jesus to come into your life, I want you just to lift your hand really high. I want to pray with you today. If there's anybody here at all, or maybe you're here and you've drifted away. You did pray that prayer some time ago, but you've kind of drifted away. Is there anybody here you want to be reconciled back to the Lord today? Anybody at all? On either one of those two calls, anybody? You have your hand up back there. I want you to come up here. Hallelujah. Anybody else? Praise God. Praise God. You want to reconcile your life back to the Lord? What's your name?
Stacy.
Stacy, you're beautiful. Thank you. Just beautiful. God is so happy. He loves you so much. He's never left. But now we just want to pray and have you turn back to him. Let's all just lift your hands towards Stacy. Here's somebody else.
You just want to be reconciled to the Lord. You've never prayed the prayer before either. What's your name?
Michelle.
Let's just lift your hands towards Michelle and Stacy. I want you girls to pray this prayer with me. Dear Lord, say it with me. Dear Lord, I ask you to forgive me for turning my back. I surrender my life to you now. I ask you to forgive me. Cleanse me. I choose this day to never turn my back on you again. I will walk with you all the days of my life. I ask you to guide me, direct me, and I will follow you. And I thank you now that I belong to you and that your spirit is on the inside of me. In Jesus' name, amen. God bless you. God bless you. Hallelujah. Are you both filled with the Holy Spirit? You filled with the Holy Spirit? Okay, you can be seated. Maybe someone can take them in another room and just minister to them. Be sure they're filled with the Holy Ghost. Now, really, one really fast, quick thing before we go to the wedding. If you're here today and you have pain or sickness in your body, you would like me to pray for you, I want you just to stand up. Just stand up where you are if you have pain or sickness in your body. Hallelujah. Hallelujah. All over this place, okay? I'm just going to stretch out my hands. You know, I don't have to lay hands on you. There's so many of you here today. I don't have to lay hands on you. But you can receive just right now in Jesus' name. Put your hand, if there's a part of your body that hurts and you want to put your hand on your head or your back or something, you can, or just lift your hands towards heaven. And if you're standing or sitting next to somebody, just reach out and put your hand upon that person that's standing up right now. Father, in the name of the Lord Jesus Christ of Nazareth, we take authority over all infirmity in Jesus' name. We give it no place, no place. I pull it down from its position of authority, and I break the power of assignment it has against my brothers and sisters. For it is written, by the stripes of Jesus, I declare you healed and whole, satisfied with long, strong life, and no weapon formed against you shall prosper. Hallelujah. Give God a glory. Glory, glory, glory. Glory, glory, glory. Hallelujah. Thank you, Lord. Thank you, Lord. Hallelujah. Feel free to go back to the tool table. Thank you, Pastor.
God bless you, Marilyn.
God bless you.
Come on, let's give a hand. God bless you.